主は主は
if you
stream live TV from 85.
I thought that being independent and self-sufficient was a really good thing. I was really connected to God. I felt powerful in my own life and in my own walk. And what
the Lord's renowned, it's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renowned, it's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renowned, it's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renowned. Together we sing.
Rico was born in 2014. He was diagnosed at the age of...
Well, good morning. It's good to see y'all's your smiling faces on a beautiful Sunday, a very special day here at Heritage, where we'll be honoring our graduates during the service. But we're here to worship one, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and we're going to worship Him forever. Let's stand together as we sing.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever, for He is good, He is above all things. His love endures forever, sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, His love endures forever, and that's been reborn. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us forever, forever.
From the rising sun,
from the rising to the setting sun, His love endures forever.
And by God the grace that we will carry on,
His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise,
sing praise,
sing praise, sing praise.
Forever,
forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever, forever.
And let's just take a brief moment and just welcome someone here this morning. Singing, He leadeth me.
He leadeth me, all blessed God, all words with heavenly comfort from. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower I will be, for by his hand he leadeth me. Sometimes it seems of deepest gloom, sometimes where Eden's powers bloom. By water still or troubled sea, still 'tis his hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower I will be, for by his hand he leadeth me. Lord, I would clasp thy hand in mine, nor never murmur nor repine. Content whatever lot I see, since 'tis thy hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me. And when my task on earth is done, when by thy grace the victory's won, in this cold wave I will not flee, since God through Jordan leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me.
Let us pray. Dear most gracious and heavenly Father, God, we are grateful, God, that you lead us. God, I pray that we be obedient to that leading, God, and that we follow you where you would have us to go, God. Take us places, God, that we can do great kingdom work for your glory and for your honor, God. I pray this morning for our service. I pray for Brother Buddy that he continues to lead us, God, and that we worship with him corporately, God, but we worship to the audience of one this morning. And God, I pray for Brother Jeff as he brings the word this morning. God, I pray that you use him as your mouthpiece, Lord, that you've anointed his words, that God, that he speaks your truth this morning. And God, for your congregation this morning, God, I pray that you prepare our hearts for the word, and God, that we are receptive of your word, God, and we don't just take it and hide it in our hearts, God, but we take it and we apply it, and we use it to further your kingdom. For us in your name we pray, amen. You can be seated. We've come to a part of our service that as a youth pastor it's always honoring and glorifying, but it's also kind of bittersweet because you've seen people grow up in your church and grow from, for Mary Catherine, from a small young lady to the young lady that she is now. So it's a great moment of our church, but it's also tough sometimes. So we're about to enter into our senior recognition. So we're going to honor our senior 2021 graduates. Our first graduate is Sarah Elizabeth Bowman. She will be graduating from Dale County High School. Sarah is the daughter of Pam and Toby Bowman. And after graduation, she will attend Wallace and later transfer to Troy University and major in secondary math education. Our next graduate is Mary Catherine Howell. She is the daughter of Stephanie and Alan Howell. She'll graduate Ashford High School. After graduation, Mary Catherine plans to attend the University of Alabama Huntsville, where she will receive a Bachelor of Science in Nursing and eventually finish with a Master's in Nursing. Our last graduate is Leanne Noelle Potter. She is the daughter of Patty and Terry Potter. She is a graduate of Houston Academy High School. After graduation, she will attend Jacksonville State University, where she will receive a double major in music education and psychology. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the graduating class of 2021. Please give them a round of applause. I will now present them our Bibles. Have a brief charge for our seniors. I'll be reading from Matthew 6:33. Most of us know this verse. So in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, it says, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God, and his righteousness, and all things shall be added to you." Most of your life, well, actually all of your life, you've grown up in a loving home where your mom and dad have guided you and directed you and helped you make decisions that are going to be the betterment of your future. So now you're getting to prepare to go off to a college. Two of you are leaving home. Sarah has the fortune of being able to live still with mom and dad and attend Wallace, but the other two are leaving. But Sarah, you two eventually will be stepping out. And as you do so, your mom and dad won't be right down the hallway. They may be a phone call away, but it won't be as easy to access them. And as you're off at school, you're going to be influenced a lot of different ways. Your professors will be trying to teach you something. Sometimes it will be consistent with what your parents have taught you. A lot of times it'll be against what parents have taught you. You have to know the background of what your parents brought you up in the Word of God. To seek first the Word of God. To seek first God, and his righteousness will be added to you. So as many people are trying to influence you in certain ways and trying to get you to do things that may be against what mom and dad taught, the most important thing you can do is lean on God's Word. When people are trying to influence you, trying to get you to do things and say things and see things, remember the Word of God. Lean into the Word of God and trust the Word of God. I'm going to pray over you guys. Dear most gracious and heavenly Father, God, I thank you for these three young women here this morning. God, I pray for peace and mercy upon them, God, as they go off to college. God, I pray for wisdom and discernment. I pray that their thoughts center on you, God, and as they are making decisions about their future. I know this morning we've talked about their plans for the future, but God, I pray that they lean into you, God, and if you decide to change those plans, God, that they be obedient, that they just be followers of you, God, that they lean into you with every decision that they have to make, God, and that they just look to you for all guidance and all wisdom. For it's in your name we pray, amen.
Wow, and I heard music education there. That is awesome, music education. So, and if you follow the order of songs that we're doing this morning, forever he leads me. And you know, wherever you go, graduates, take the name of Jesus with you, and it's a great name. So we're kind of telling a little story with our song. So we're going to continue singing. And I'm going to let you remain seated for this next song, Take the Name of Jesus With You.
Name, oh sweet, oh
Jesus. So wherever you go, take that name with you. We're gonna do this song. It's called Your Great Name. And let's stand together as we sing. Lost stop. Wait. Sorry. We're not going to be in the right key. I think I'd like that key better, but lost are saved, find their way at the sound. Redeemer, Redeemer, my healer, Lord Almighty, Defender, my Savior, you are my King. Redeemer, my healer, Lord Almighty, Defender, my Savior.
Quiet all of a sudden. Good morning, everybody. Great to see you. Good to see all these folks down front. Good to have visitors with us today. And we're so grateful for our graduates this year. And I'm excited about what God's going to do in their lives. And I know that God is pleased with them and the efforts that they have put forth in their education. And our prayer is that they're going to go out and be world changers for Jesus Christ. Well, this morning, take your Bibles, and I want you to turn over to Genesis chapter 13. Genesis chapter 13, we're going to be looking at verses 1 through 18. And I'll give you a moment or two to find that portion of Scripture. And when you have found it, would you stand with me in honor and in reverence to reading God's Word? Genesis chapter 13, beginning with verse 1. Then Abram went up from Egypt, he and his wife, and all that he had, and Lot with him, to the south. Abram was very rich in livestock, in silver, and in gold. And he went on his journey from the south as far as Bethel, to the place where his tent had been at the beginning, between Bethel and Ai, to the place of the altar which he had made there at first. And there Abram called on the name of the Lord. Lot also, who went with Abram, had flocks and herds and tents. And now the land was not able to support them, that they might dwell together, for their possessions were so great that they could not dwell together. And there was strife between the herdsmen of Abraham's livestock and the herdsmen of Lot's livestock. The Canaanites and the Perizzites then dwelt in the land. And Abram said to Lot, "Please let there be no strife between you and me and between my herdsmen and your herdsmen, for we are brethren. Is not the whole land before you? Please separate from me. If you take the left, then I will go to the right. Or if you go to the right, then I will go to the left." And Lot lifted his eyes, and he saw the plain of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, as you go towards Zoar. Then Lot chose for himself all the plain of Jordan, and Lot journeyed east. And they separated from each other. Abram dwelt in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelt in the cities of the plain and pitched his tent even as far as Sodom. But the men of Sodom were exceedingly wicked and sinful against the Lord. And the Lord said to Abram, after Lot had separated from him, "Lift your eyes now and look for the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, and westward. For all the land which you see, I give to you and your descendants forever. And I will make your descendants as the dust of the earth, so that if a man could number the dust of the earth, then your descendants also could be numbered. Arise, walk in the land through its length and its width, for I give it to you. Then Abram moved his tent and went and dwelt by the terebinth trees of Mamre, which are in Hebron, and built an altar there to the Lord. Let's pray together. Our Father, we come before you today thanking you for the privilege that we have to come into your house. And we want to lift up the name of Jesus in this place. And I pray that each of us at this time in the service where we have sung, now we turn our attention to your written and spoken word. And Father, I pray that we'd sense your presence very powerful in this place. Your word tells us that when two or three are gathered in your name, that there you're also. To know that we've come, that we are worshiping you in presence. I pray this morning as I stand and preach in just a moment, Father, I acknowledge how much I need you. I'm nothing without you. And Father, I pray that you would anoint my life. I pray that you would give me the energy, and I pray that you'd give me the boldness. I pray that I would stand on the authority of your word. And God, may we receive what you have to say to us. Father, may it penetrate the deep places of our hearts and lives today. But Father, we claim your promise. It says that your word will not return void. And we pray and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. There's so much here as we have started this series about a bold faith. About Abram, we know that God changes his name to Abraham a little bit later on. But last Sunday we discovered the way that you and I have bold obedience is by faith. Having faith. In bold obedience, Abram went from Ur all the way to Haran to Canaan. Then, because of the famine, he left the will of God. Now, let's not look too spiritual as we're looking at Abram this morning, because we too have been guilty of doing the very same thing. There's times that we have left the will of God and we've chosen to do our own thing. And we're going to see the results of that today. But he went down to the fertile banks of the Nile River to Egypt. Now, if you've been watching commercials recently, you know that the MyPillow fella, what's his name, Mike Lindell, he makes some sheets. And those sheets are called Giza sheets. And when he's doing his commercial, he shows you where this cotton is grown in order to make these sheets. Well, if in your mind you've seen that, that's kind of where this is taking place. But after the humiliating experience of being caught by Pharaoh in a lie about his wife Sarai at this point, about being his sister, he was deported to Egypt. Now, we understand that concept of being deported these days. But then we read here in verses 1 and 2, it says, "Then Abram went up from Egypt, he and his wife and all that he had, and Lot with him to the south. Abram was very rich in livestock and silver and in gold." And what this tells us is that Abram went all the way back to the place that God had originally commanded him. And folks, when we get off doing our own thing and we find out that we've displeased God, that we've sinned against God, that's some very good advice. You need to go back to where it began. It says, "To the place of the altar, which he had made there, and there Abram called on the name of the Lord." So what we know is that he's been greatly humbled. You ever been humbled before? Y'all smile at me. You don't have a mask on today. Some of you. I can tell whether you're awake. But what happens here is that, you know, God has a way of humbling us, doesn't he? I've had to eat some humble pie before, but that's what's taking place. God had humbled him in his experience in Egypt, and Abram now calls upon the Lord. He undoubtedly confessed his sin, and what we know from reading this is that he's fully restored in his fellowship with God. Now, I'm just going to say this morning that if you are a believer of the Lord Jesus Christ this morning and you're out of fellowship with him, I'm just going to tell you something. That's a miserable way to live your life. And it could be that some of us here today that maybe we're off doing our own thing and maybe we've drifted away from the Lord. And I'm going to tell you something. If you are out of fellowship with him, it is a miserable experience. Abram is a wonderful example of somebody that gets out of the will of God and what you and I should do, and what the Lord does during that time. When we sin, the devil will immediately rush in to tell us that we've messed up, and he'll tell us that there's absolutely no way to return. That is a lie. That is a lie that the devil wants you to hear and listen, and he wants you to believe. But God has always been a God of the second chance. He is a God of a third chance. Matter of fact, you can go on and multiply that any way you want to. That's the way our God is. Now, in Genesis 13, we can learn a wonderful lesson here by contrasting Abram and Lot. And when it comes to making decisions, we as Christians, we're either like Abram or sometimes we're like Lot. Abram made his decision based on spiritual priorities. What's your priorities today? Is it what you want? Is it to be accepted? Or do you have some spiritual priorities in your life? You see, Abram had spiritual priorities. Lot had materialistic priorities. You see the conflict there. I want us to learn this morning how you and I can avoid bad decisions. And I know that we've got some graduates here this morning. I pray that you'll take this message and make an application of you in your lives. Because I can guarantee you that your parents, your grandparents, your friends, and your neighbors or whoever's here with you this morning, they don't want you to make any bad decisions. If you'll wait on the Lord, listen, he will guide you. His intention for you is for you not to make bad decisions, but you've got to humble yourself and you've got to submit yourself under his authority. Now, the first thing that I want us to see this morning, you say, well, preacher, you hadn't got to that first point yet. Well, I'm getting to it right now. I want you to notice this morning the circumstances of Lot's bad decision. Now, in verses 5 through 9, what we find is that Lot had a great material wealth. He wasn't lacking for things. Matter of fact, the scripture says, for he had flocks and herds and tents. And then if you look down at verse 7, it also reveals that the Canaanites and the Perizzites, that they dwelt in the land. Now, they're mentioned here for a reason. The reason that they're mentioned is because they were also using the pasture land, and they weren't very accommodating to foreigners like Abram and Lot. And I think it also should be noted that these pagans were probably observing very closely the conflict between Abram and Lot's herdsmen. People are watching us. They're watching every move we make, and they want to see if what we have is really real or not. They were watching Abram and Lot to see how this was going to play out. Now, when there is friction, when there is disputing in the church, I can promise you that the lost community is going to know about it. They're going to know about it. The devil I promise you we'll see to it that they know. The world knows that we'll disagree, so they're not watching to see if we disagree. They're watching to see how we disagree. And Abram, I think, gives us the greatest example in the Bible that you'll find how to handle disagreements. Look what he says to Lot. Please let there be no strife between you and me and between my herdsmen and your herdsmen, for we are brethren. You see that? Is not the whole land before you? Please separate from me. If you take the left, then I'll go to the right. And if you go to the right, then I'll go to the left. I want you to notice something here. There's some spiritual humility that's taking place here. Some sacrifice on Abram's part. Abram was willing to yield his right. Now, that's not something that we're taught much these days about yielding yourself, yielding your right. Our world teaches us to make sure that we get what's ours and don't settle for anything less. Not about yielding yourself, yielding what you want. Listen, also, socially, what you find is that Abram was Lot's senior. Back in those days, it would have been Lot's responsibility to have allowed Abram to choose first. But that's what you don't find there. What you find is that Abram, he is humbling himself and he's sacrificing what he wants in order to make sure that his brethren and him are in a good place. You know, the world would probably label Abram as being foolish to yield his rights and his position for the sake of harmony. Friends, I want you to know something. What Satan loves to do in the local church is to create disharmony. And don't think for one moment that he can't find things. He can find the most trivial, minute little things and divide people over it. Unity is something that you and I, it should be important to us, and we should be willing to do anything necessary that we can in order to make sure that unity is intact here in our church. Abram was concerned with the spiritual, but Lot was concerned about the material. But there's another thing that I want you to see this morning. And I want you to see the cause of Lot's bad decision. Now, pick up with me here in the scripture in verse 10 through 13. The cause of Lot's bad decision, I think, is pretty clear here in verse 10. It says, "And Lot lifted his eyes, and he saw all the plain of Jordan," like a kid in a candy shop. And he says, "that it is well watered everywhere, like the land of Egypt, as you go toward Zoar." Lot, what he's doing is he looked at the options. He saw the plain of Jordan. He saw that it was a great place to be able to raise cattle. And it says, "Therefore Lot chose for himself all the plain of Jordan." Lot journeyed east, and they separated from each other. Lot wasn't concerned of what God wanted in this situation. Lot was concerned how he was going to make money. Lot was concerned about how this was going to prosper him. He was looking at the material, while, of course, Abram was looking at the spiritual. But he should have been looking at a great place to be able to raise his family, but that wasn't on his radar. And there are many Christians like Lot who make bad decisions because they put a better job, they put a better career and advancement above their family's spiritual well-being. Listen, you may get a better job, but you may lose your family in the midst of it. Because Lot's number one priority was money, he moved from the highlands of Bethel down to the plains of Jordan. And the plain of Jordan is the area where the Jordan River enters into the Dead Sea. Now, like many believers who make choices based on material concerns, what you find is when Lot thought that he was giving up in life, he was actually really going down. What you think might be prosperous, what you think might line your pockets, listen, it may cost you more than you're willing to pay. And I think that's what happens here as you look at this story. And I think that it's significant that this is the first place that the Bible mentions riches and wealth. First time in the Bible. Listen, there's nothing wrong with being rich. Absolutely nothing wrong being rich, because Abram and Lot were both wealthy. But the important thing is that your wealth doesn't need to own you. And there's many people that sometimes they may have a lot of money, but their money actually is in charge of their lives. Again, it's all right to have money as long as it doesn't have you. Lot was aware of God's word and his promise to bless Abram, but listen, his concern for the monetary things caused him to ignore God's word to Abram and dwell in an area that was clearly out of the will of God. Now, Lot made a bad decision to go to the plain of Jordan, so separating himself from the influence of his godly uncle Abram. Now, the Holy Spirit adds this: Abram dwelt in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelt in the cities of the plain and pitched his tent. And I want you to notice that it's added here, it was in there, but it's significant. It says, even so far as Sodom. Now, we all know the story about Sodom and Gomorrah. We know that it's a terrible place to live. It says, but the men of Sodom were exceedingly wicked and sinful. Exceedingly. Not partially. Not some of them. Not just mediocre. It says they were exceedingly wicked and sinful against the Lord. So the progression of Lot's demise is beginning to go down that slippery slope. First, he settled his eyes on the plain of Jordan. Then he dwelled in the city of the plain. In other words, he moved towards Sodom. And then what you find is that Lot continued to move south. And finally, he pitched his tent as far as Sodom. He said, well, preacher, what does that mean? Let me kind of put this in layman's terms for just a moment. Sodom would represent being as far away from God as you could get. And the scripture says here that Lot pitched his tent as far as Sodom. What that tells me is this. Sometimes, as believers, we know that something is not right. We know that the Word of God says that this is wrong. But sometimes in our humanness, in our worldliness sometimes, what we do is we try to get our lives as close to the edge without going over the edge. I believe the Word of God. The Word of God says that Jesus said, lo, I'm with you always. I don't like heights. I'm not crazy about getting up on high things. But listen, if you are standing at the edge of a cliff, the most dangerous place for you to be is at the edge. But that's the very thing that we do sometimes as believers. We pitch our tent just as close to sin as we can without sinning, but that's the most dangerous place to be. Listen, if you are back over yonder in the parking lot somewhere, you don't have to worry about the cliff because you're not going to fall off of it. The thing that you need to do is get yourself as far away from that cliff as you can get. But there's just something that draws us, our sinfulness, our sinful nature sometimes, that we're not just going to go right out there and sin, but sometimes we park our lives way too close to it. Y'all with me? All right. So, what that means to us is this. I think that probably Lot never intended to go into a pagan territory. I don't think that that was necessarily his intention. But, you know, that's the way the devil does. That's the way he does. He gets us into the depths of sin one step at a time. You give the devil an inch, he takes a mile. You give him a second, he'll take a lifetime. You give him a thought, and listen, he'll take that thought and he'll turn it into reality. Now, what makes it all even worse is that Lot continued to live in Sodom. He didn't leave. He stayed there. And as we'll see in chapter 19, when God's judgment came on Sodom, Lot lost all of his possessions and he lost his wife. Now, if that were not enough, the moral slime of Sodom had so influenced his daughters that they got their father drunk and slept with him and bore his children. That's how low it got. That's how bad being that close to Sodom had affected Lot's family. Lot never dreamed that what looked so good on that plain of Jordan was going to turn out so bad for his family. But that's the way sin is. Sin always looks good, and it seems fun, and it seems rewarding for a season, and nobody would be tempted to sin if we looked around us and we saw that it made people miserable. We don't want to see that. We wouldn't be interested in sin if we thought that it was going to immediately hurt us. The cause of Lot's bad decision was his desire for material possessions. Now, friends, we're living in a day and time in our culture that, listen, that drives people to have stuff, to have the latest cars, and I'm not necessarily against those things, but to have every kind of possession imaginable. Listen, things don't satisfy. Jesus does. Now, it looked good to him, and it looked good for a season, but it sowed the seeds of greed. And when it sowed the seeds of greed in Lot's life, listen, the harvest produced greed. Now, the last thing that I want you to see this morning is the contrast to Lot's bad decision. Now, in verses 14 through 18, Lot's bad decision were Abraham's good one, Abram's unselfish apparently pleased the Lord. But listen, it made God angry. Look at verse 14. And the Lord said to Abram, after Lot had separated from him, lift your eyes now and look from the place where you are northward, southward, eastward, and westward. Abram waited until the Lord told him to lift his eyes. And while Lot decided to do his own thing. Lot was only concerned about himself. Abram waited on God to give the land, and Lot greedily took it. Now, God also told Abraham that he would give him that land, it says, descendants forever, and that his descendants would be, as it says, as the dust of the earth, so that if a man could number the dust of the earth, then your descendants also could be numbered. Listen, God's arithmetic's not like the world's. The world says you gain by getting all you can get, holding on to it, investing it. On the other hand, God's economy, we gain by losing. Don't miss that. We gain by losing. And that's the way things work in God's economy. Abram believed that though he was willing to give up was rightfully his, that God would still keep his promise. And verse 17, God commands Abram, "Arise, walk in the land through its length and its width, for I give it to you." You see, the blessing of God upon Abram was based on his participation. The blessings of God in our lives, it's not without effort on our part. We have at times got to put feet to our faith. When God says to go this way and do it that way, that doesn't mean that we just pack our bags and sit there. It means that we've got to move in the direction that God has us to go. But we've got to take one step at a time. And the way that we do that is through prayer, Bible study, worship, and faithfully serving the Lord. Just a step at a time. One by one by one. And in response to God's command, it says in verse 18, Abram moved his tent and went and dwelt by the terebinth trees of Mamre, which are in Hebron, and built an altar there for the Lord. Now, if you didn't catch this, I want you to know this is the third time that Abram built an altar. The third time. A place where he could go worship, a place that he can meditate and pray. You see, Lot made a disastrous decision, and we know the terrible consequences of it. There are several reasons for this bad decision. First of all, he was greedy, and he made his decision based solely on finances. Secondly, he chose the way of immediate gratification. Is that not where we are today? He neglected the long-term effects and only thought about the moment. But thirdly, Lot had no altar. There was no altar. There was no family altar where they worshiped and where they prayed. And the fourth thing you see is this, that Lot didn't learn the lessons by the bad decisions. You know, fortunately, we can read and study and hear a message about this, but what I want you to see is this. Listen, we can learn from people like Abram. We can learn from people like Lot and Moses and David and Paul. We can learn from these people. Wouldn't it be foolish to know that if you did this, then the results are that, and we go and do it anyway? Listen, we can study the Word of God, and we can see that, listen, sometimes godly people made some bad decisions, made some wrong choices in life. But the good thing is, what you see in the life of Abram is that God received him. God welcomed him back. Now, I don't know where you are this morning, and I don't know where what's going on in your life, and you seniors that are here this morning, I don't know where all God's going to take you. But you can either live like Abram, or you can live like Lot. It's a choice that you and I make. Listen, the choices that you and I make, listen, they're going to have consequences to them. They'll have consequences to them. But listen, do not believe the lie that Satan tells us, that if you blow it, if you mess up, that it's over, that God will never forgive you. Well, everybody look at me for just a moment. There's nothing you and I will ever do to cause God to love us any less. Nothing. He loves us. Hates sin, but loves us. And more than willing to forgive us and redeem us and to bless us. You can do it Abram's way or Lot's. It's a choice that we make. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes with me just a moment? Again, I don't know where you are in your heart and life and what's happening with you. But listen, God does. God knows. And every one of us in here, if you've not made a bad decision, most likely in your life, you probably will. Listen, our God is a God of second chances. But I'm telling you, it's pretty foolish for us to make bad decisions and not learn from it. This morning, if you're here and you've never put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, that really is the single most important decision that you really need to consider this morning. If you don't know Him, you need to know Him. Some of you are here and you're miserable and you've tried everything in life, but it doesn't seem to satisfy you. Listen, Jesus is all that. Jesus will satisfy. He will forgive you of your sin, and He will give you eternal life. If you need to be saved today, I'll be glad to share with you what the Bible says you need to do to be saved. This morning, if you're a believer and you find that maybe you've been out into the far country, and maybe you're like Lot this morning, and maybe you've pitched your tent too close to Sodom today. Listen, God's not as concerned about the direction that your feet were pointed in yesterday. He's concerned about the direction that your feet are pointing in right now. Some of us maybe need to recommit ourselves, rededicate ourselves afresh and anew today. Or maybe the Lord's dealing with you about your membership. Listen, we're not a twist-your-arm, high-pressure church. But listen, if God has spoken and you know this is where He wants you to be, we'd welcome you to come. Be a part of this fellowship. Or maybe you're going through a storm and a problem and a difficulty at this very moment. Maybe you want to come and kneel down front. Nobody's going to be offended by that. But in the next few moments, what is it that we're to do with what God's told us today? What are you to do with what you've heard? What is it that God's speaking to your heart about this morning? I'm going to close with a word of prayer, and then we're going to sing, and we're going to have our invitation hymn, and I pray that the Holy Spirit would fall fresh on our congregation this morning. I pray that we'll see a mighty move of God in this place. Father, we thank You. We love You. We thank You for Your Word. And Father, we'd be foolish to not see how You worked in Abram's life and to see the bad decision that Lot made. God, would we pick up our lives and our families and move as far away from sin as we can get? Would You speak to every heart and every mind in this place today? May we be drawn to Your throne of grace this morning. Have Your way in us in these next few moments, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together as Brother Buddy comes to lead us in our invitation hymn. I'm going to be down front. Brother Donnie will be down front. But we certainly want to receive you in any decisions that need to be made today. Let's sing.
Take my life, lead me, Lord. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Make my life useful to Thee. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Make my life useful to Take my life, teach me, Lord. Take my life, teach me, Lord. Make my life useful to Thee. Take my life, teach me, Lord. Take my life, teach me, Lord. Make my life useful to Make my life useful to
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time, God's good. Thank you so much for being here today. Before we dismiss, Brother Donnie's got some announcements for us. Will you mention about the discipleship thing on Tuesday mornings, or do you want me to do it? Okay, all right. You can be seated just a moment.
Have just a few announcements this morning. We have our men's, Brother Jeff was asking about the men's discipleship Bible study. That is on Tuesday mornings at 6:30. It will meet in the fellowship hall. There are books. So those books are $20 a piece. If you're interested, you can see Brother Toby or Brother Jeff, and they'll be glad to help you and point you in the right direction. Our student life camp is fast approaching. Still have 3 spots available, but I have to turn those the numbers in this week. So if you have a student who hasn't signed up but would like to go, please see me today and so I can get those turned in. We do have dates for our Vacation Bible School. That is June the 21st through the 24th. That's a Monday through a Thursday. And if you can help and you're willing to help, please see Ms. Dawn Davis, and she will get you put in the place that she needs the most help. Also, we have our senior recognition. Our fellowship is in the back. Everyone is welcome. It's for everyone, not just for seniors and their families. It's for everyone. So if you don't have lunch plans, we would love to see you back in the back to come take part in that. The fellowship team has been back there working hard this morning and are set up and ready for you guys. So we would love for you to come back with the seniors and celebrate them and just give them a big hug and tell them how much you love them. And I believe Brother David has closing prayer this morning. Seniors, before you go to the back, though, if you'll grab your cap and gowns and come down front. I know some families would like pictures, so everyone else can make their way to the back. Seniors, we'll get our pictures done, and then we'll meet them back there.
Hey, all seriousness, folks, come on back and eat, and let's have a good fellowship and celebrate these seniors and send them off. So let's just pray. Lord God, I thank you for our seniors that are graduating, Lord, for the things that you'll be doing in their life, Lord. God, I ask you to guide them and direct them and keep them close to you throughout their life, Lord, so they may be honoring and pleasing to you, Lord Jesus. For the people that impact, Lord, for the glory of your kingdom, Lord God. Lord, thank you for this message that you've given us, Lord, and thank you for this fellowship, and I thank you for this church. In your holy name, I praise you, Lord. Amen.